Hi everyone, and welcome back to Coffee with Jane and Bobby. I'm absolutely delighted to reintroduce you all to Bobby Capuccio, who's a bit poorly this week and still resident in New York. So Bobby, you're going to talk about transformational experiences this week. So go ahead, let us have it.
Well, this story goes back to 2001, where I was sitting with, at the time, the head of training collectively for a company called Town Sports International that owned, you know, well over 140 locations at the time. They've grown since then. And her name was Alexandra Brinsmay. And she called me into the office and literally locked the door and said, "We're not leaving until we can clearly define in three words or less what every single fitness professional, whether group exercise instructor, whether personal trainer, floor instructor, regardless, does for a living, and how does it connect to the member and what they get out of it and their desired outcomes." And what we came up with in that room was the phrase transformational experiences, which means the experience and the change and the emotive mental state of the person, present tense, every single visit to our facility is just as, if not more important than the outcome they seek, because behaviors and efforts are the medium by which the outcome is produced. And this is really relevant in the group exercise arena, because I think Group X gets this, if not explicitly, intuitively, and implicitly at the very least. When you come into a room, you're with other people, you have a psychosocial dynamic, you have choreography, you have music. So yes, you're exercising, yes, you're working towards a goal, but more than that, you're there to move and to congregate with people that evoke a certain emotional state. Everybody's got their favorite class, their favorite instructor, the person that if they don't show up for class one day, some member somewhere is going to have an aneurysm because they look forward to either the pleasure or the pain that they lose if they don't go there. So people go to group exercise classes even when they're not goal seeking. They're tension relieving, basically. It's an outlet. It's the thing that they look forward to most. I think when you look at behavior change, which is what we're all trying to elicit, one of the pioneers of behavior change, Albert Bandura of social cognitive theory, talks about how to increase self-efficacy, and self-efficacy is defined as the belief that you are capable of initiating and then sustaining a certain behavior. So without self-efficacy, no change is possible. And one of the ways to affect self-efficacy is through kinesthetic experience. Changing the way we move changes the information to our brain. So when we're moving in a certain way, and we're feeling a certain way, and we repeat that over and over, well, getting us to feel that way has an effect on the dopaminergic pathways, which makes our brain say, "Hey, you know what? I kind of enjoyed that. I'd like to repeat that." And if we do repeat it, if we go to a class on Tuesday, then repeat it that Thursday, then the following Tuesday, we've already started to initiate a behavior pattern that gives us a reputation that we need to live up to. And I think transformational experiences, focusing on what's the emotion and what's the experience, just as much as the scientific rationale of exercise, selection, modification, and programming, is really important because it ministers to three C's that all of us, whether we're personal trainers, and even if our environment is a group exercise class, needs to adhere to in order to drive adherence. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
so far.
Very much so.
And those three C's, just to get to the point, are clarity, consent, and commitment. The first thing we need to do is get really clear with ourselves and with our clients when we're in the role of a coach as to what exactly do you want. And what are the consequences of getting it? If you got it, what would be different in your life tangibly? How would that feel? And if you didn't get that, if you missed it, what sense of loss, what sense of pain would missing that goal evoke? And what are the most painful consequences? And how does that feel? And given your values and given all of your priorities in your life, why are those particular set of consequences so pertinent to you in the first place? Now, once you're clear, the second step is consent. And that doesn't mean you get permission from anybody else, but you give yourself permission to be the best version of yourself. And a lot of times what affects our willingness to give ourselves consent to transcend who we are to who we're capable of being is recognizing past achievements. See, in order to change who we are or where we are in the future, we need to engage in certain behavior patterns in the present that are influenced by how we remember or define our level of self-efficacy in the past. So if you're able to create an environment that allows somebody to show up for a second, third, fourth session, or fourth, fifth class that you've been teaching for the past few months, that person already starts to elevate their level of self-efficacy because they've shown consistency and they're building a successful track record. And from there, someone has the belief that they can initiate and sustain a behavior. They're able to set the strategic steps in place that allows them to commit to adhering to those steps, those behaviors that can bring their future vision into their current reality. So transformational experience focuses on the outcome by creating the experience in the present. Does that make sense?
It does. I'm with you. I love that.
Well, thank you.
Are you finished?
I'm finished. I'm sorry. I'm a bit succinct today. I'm still under the weather.
Today. No, that's short, brilliant. So let me just wind this up. Let me just ask you one question. So people who don't adhere to exercise, are they getting back in touch with their negative past experiences? Is it the negatives that stop them from coming back? Or is it that we're not creating the environment where they're comfortable? Or whether we can nurture the positive experience?
You know, Jane, it might be a little bit of both. I think there are, I was just having a conversation on Facebook today with someone I respect very, very much, Nikki Benfatto, and we were talking about no single factor ever contributes completely to the initiation or cessation of a behavior pattern. Right. I think several factors are in play, and yes, people do look back at past experiences, and not just the past experiences, because how the brain works is in order to recall a memory, you have to change the neural network that memory belongs to just a little bit.
Right.
So every time we recall a memory, we have to change it a bit. So given our emotional state, if we're coming into the gym or the group X room and we're afraid, we're intimidated, that's going to affect the way we recall past experiences, and we might recall them in a way that's not as encouraging. We might remember the one time that we didn't show up for class, or the one time we quit the gym and we experienced recidivism back to our original state before we joined, rather than the three other times in our life where we were able to adhere to exercise for 6 months to a year successfully. But whatever that experience is, that contributes to certain belief patterns, which creates certain thought patterns, which leads to attitudes and emotions that drive or inhibit behaviors. So yes, our appraisal of past experiences is something that's quite profound in affecting our behaviors. And when we show up, what is it that the instructor does or fails to do that either enhances or ruins us? So if we find that we're safe and we're able to perform with a level of proficiency, and we walk out of there feeling invigorated, we walk out of there feeling a modicum of confidence, that's more likely to lead to a repeat in that behavior than if we walk out of there feeling that we lost proficiency, we lost confidence, and mastery is impossible. If you take a look at Mahali Csikszentmihalyi, the author of the book Flow, he is a world-class expert in peak experiences, and activity has to be at the outer limit of your capability. If it's too hard, we get anxious. If it's too easy, we get bored. Finding that sweet spot is essential not only for improvement measurably, but enjoyment intrinsically, which drives behavior if you look at DC and Ryan and their self-determination theory.
Yeah, cool. That's given us a lot to work on in the future as well. It's great to have you back, Bobby. Great to have you back. And I'm sure everyone's looking forward to future installments of our coffee. Well, it's more like a tea afternoon now, isn't it? Afternoon tea now.
Dang, you just walked out. I'm sorry. But it's great to be back. I miss you. Coffee's just not the same without you.
I'm sure.
It doesn't even taste right.
I'm sure. Right. See you next week, my love.